My name is Carol Homden. I'm the Group Chief Executive of Coram, which was established 280 years ago. And we opened our doors this day to the first children admitted to the care of the Foundling Hospital. And on this occasion, we come together today to ask what has changed and what needs to change, to explore the public attitudes to care, past, present and future. Today's event is a webinar. It is being recorded and you will be able to ask questions through the question and answer function later in the event. You'll have to adjust your own sound. I can't do that for you, and to make yourself comfortable in that way. We're going to take something around an hour and a quarter to explore these issues together, showcasing the fabulous work of young people today under our Voices Through Time Story of Care programme. And to introduce that programme and the way we're going to consider the issues today, I first of all would like to introduce the video by Jules Brown. It will sometimes take a short moment for such videos to join us, so please bear with us.
Voices Through Time.
Hello, I'm Julian Brown. I'm a Care Ambassador for Coram's Voices Through Times project, which is funded by the National Lottery Heritage Fund. I'm also the host of a brand new podcast, which is called Foundling Founds. In this podcast, we will go through the archives from the Voices Through Times project, which date back to 1739. When the Foundling Hospital was first founded. We'll also look at the archives and how they relate to the present day care system and what we would like to see change ahead of the care review this year. We will also be hearing very many different experiences of young people who have been in the care system or left the care system, and also multi-generational experiences of the care system. We will also look at the stigmas that those in care face, whether it's through the media's perception or society in general, or the settings that that stigma is in. We'll also have some very special guests on who have either been a part in the media perception of those in care or been in part of a conversation around those in care.
Thank you, Jules. So as you can see, this is part of a major programme of work being undertaken by Coram, examining the past to inform the present. And we're going to start our story tonight, our story through time, with our social historian, Carol Harris, who will examine what was happening, what was the public attitude to care when Thomas Coram began his progressive and radical campaigning to create this place, the Foundling Hospital. Thank you, Carol.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to start with a quick run through, as it's always a quick run through, a couple of hundred years of history, or nearly 300 years. Let me just start the screen and just bear with me a second and just, oh, let's have a look at this. Excuse me a minute. We go. Okay, right, so public attitudes. I'm going to do mainly the past and leave the present and future to others, but I think you can see here now our story starts with the Foundling Hospital. Here's a contemporary drawing, fairly accurate, from 1739, when the Foundling Hospital was built. It was established by Thomas Coram, our founder. It's really important right from the start that we get our heads around how very different Thomas Coram's attitudes were to the prevailing ideas of the time. He was a humanitarian. He was a latitudinarian, which is always a good word to get into anything like this. What that meant was he was a committed Christian, but it was practical Christianity rather than religious rituals that concerned him. You practiced your faith ideally through doing good deeds. He came to London, having spent time in America in the early 1700s. And on his return, he was horrified by the number of children who were babies, who were abandoned and exposed and deserted, as he termed them, in the streets of London. And he campaigned for 17 years to set up a Foundling Hospital as a place where they could be taken. Foundling hospitals were being set up in across Europe at this time, but there was massive resistance in this country to the idea. He had two motivations. He was essentially, first, it was practical. These babies could be saved, they could grow into good citizens for the nation, was one idea. His other idea, much more important to him, was that of the humanitarian aspect. It was worth saving them simply because it was a good, decent thing to do. It was a moral perspective, as I say, very much at odds with society at the time. At the time, society generally regarded the idea of children being saved as dangerous. The children he saw abandoned on the streets, the babies left to die in just piles of rubbish, they were left by women who could not afford to admit to having had a child outside of marriage. The idea of having a child outside of marriage would bring on a woman destitution. Her virtue would be compromised. She would infect other women with her immoral behaviour. And people generally thought that if you tried to help the children that such women had, then it would merely encourage them to have more children and behave promiscuously. And Thomas Coram found this an incredible, offensive idea that, as I say, puts him really at odds with society. And so it took him 17 years of campaigning to get support for what he always regarded as his darling project, as he called it, amongst the many campaigns for good that he professed. He actually, in 1734, while he was campaigning for support to open the Foundling Hospital, he wrote to his friend, the Reverend Benjamin Coleman, said, "I found it was impossible to be done, for I could no more prevail with any of them if I had tried it to put down their breeches and present their backsides to the king and queen in a full drawing room. Such was the unchristian shyness of all about the court. So that's what he felt. As you can see from that, Thomas was not a man to mince words. He despaired of getting support from the great and the good at times, but he kept on. And in fact, in 1739, he got his royal charter. And in 1741, the first children, the first babies, were received into the Foundling Hospital. It's worth thinking about how society viewed this. And to do that, to look at Henry Fielding's book, Tom Jones, a classic work today, a bestseller in the time it was published in the 1740s. And in Tom Jones, which is the story of a foundling, Henry Fielding has a character called Mrs. Deborah, and she really sums up the attitude of the time to foundlings and to the dangerous work that Thomas Coram was doing in terms of its effects on society. Mrs. Deborah, this is her reaction in the book to the discovery of the infant Tom Jones, the foundling character. She says, "For my own part, it goes against me to touch these misbegotten creatures whom I don't look upon as my fellow creatures. I would have put it in a basket, sent out and laid at the church warden's door. It is 2-1, but it lives till it is found in the morning. But if it should not, we have discharged our duty in taking proper care of it. And it is perhaps better for such creatures to die in a state of innocence than to grow up and imitate their mothers, for nothing better can be expected of them." So it was a tough call for Thomas. And on that first night in 1741, when the first children were taken in, I thought it was 280 years ago, give or take an hour and a quarter from now, at 8 o'clock, the light was extinguished over the door of the Foundling Hospital. And the advertisement that invited women to bring their babies to its door said, "The house will be open, or will be open for children until it is full. No question asked whatsoever of any person who brings a child, nor shall any servant of the hospital presume to inquire on pain of being dismissed." So it was very clear that anonymity, at least as far as the Foundling Hospital was concerned, would be guaranteed. And that's how the first foundlings were admitted. This is a fairly idealised site in terms of the women queuing at the Foundling Hospital building that actually wasn't built in 1741. It wasn't finished till a few years later. In fact, what happened was that there were large groups of spectators. The hospital was overwhelmed with women trying to bring babies to its doors, even though on that first night it only had places for 30. The criteria were that however many places it had were filled, once that was that they were filled, that was it. The other criterion was that the child should be free from infection. And here we see in the bottom right is an attempt to deal with the huge numbers of women who brought their babies in. They brought in a lottery system very soon, so that invited women into a room within the Foundling Hospital rather than have the public event outside with all the spectators. Women would choose a ball from a bag. If it was a white ball, their child was in, subject to inspection for infection. If it was an orange ball, the child was on a reserve list. If it was a black ball, the woman and her baby were taken out as the child would not be admitted and accompanied to make sure they did not leave their child anyway at the door of the building. It really, again, still is not about stigma. It is about taking the stigma away and allowing the women to bring their children, hand them over with a degree of anonymity, very radical for the time. The babies were taken immediately to foster mothers, wet nurses mostly, and for the first few years they spent their lives with the foster mothers in foster care, and then they were brought back to the institution. The anonymity of the mother was, in terms of the stigma, absolutely paramount in the way the child was recorded in the institution. So it was, this is a page from the billet books that are part of our collection. And each page the child's details were recorded, just in case the mother could come and reclaim the child. In fact, that very, very rarely happened. But those billet books were sealed so that no one else could see them unless the mother returned. The idea of the popularity of the Foundling Hospital really caught the imagination of some parts of society. And so in 1756, Parliament voted the period of general reception, as it was called. And that was a period of about 4 years, during which time any child that was brought to the Foundling Hospital would be taken in. Parliament not only decreed that should be the case, but also, crucially, voted the money to do so. Unfortunately, the levels of infection were such that out of 15,000 children brought to it over the next 4 years, around 10,000 of them died. That was typical, probably slightly better mortality rates than were typical of the time. But it showed the scale of need amongst women and children of the time, despite public attitudes. It didn't mean that public attitudes had massively changed in many ways, but it did mean that that the Foundling Hospital had some influence in Parliament in order to make that happen. They, in order to cope with the numbers, Foundling Hospital branches were set up all over the country. And it's telling that in terms of, this is one of the Foundling Hospital branch hospitals set up at that time in Shrewsbury. It's telling that they actually wrote to the governors from the Foundling Hospital in Shrewsbury and asked if they could change its name to Orphan Hospital, as you see here, because the stigma of being a foundling was much worse even than being an orphan. And our archives are full of all sorts of telling comments about the attitudes of the time. For example, Thomas Trent in 1757 wrote to the governors to say that a dignitary of this neighbourhood has thought fit to refuse a child a Christian burial in his churchyard. It was regarded that the parish officers regarded it as a problem to have found too many foundlings, as they put it, in their parishes, even though the foundlings were themselves funded, not by the parishes, but by the Foundling Hospital. Foundling Hospital archives also contain reports that farmers would rather pour the milk away from their cows than let it be given to the foundlings in the district. But it wasn't all bad news. Sometimes the inspectors' reports talk about the very positive attitudes there are to the foundlings locally. And one of the things that's quite telling is that the foster mothers themselves sometimes hold on to the Foundling Hospital, the foundling uniforms, and give them to their own children. So the stigma of the Foundling Hospital is by no means universal at that point. So the idea of the general reception ends quite soon. And after that, only children whose fathers have died on active service are taken in to the hospital for a few years. It doesn't, again, really change fundamentally the attitudes that we see. This is a hymn book from the time, written for a hymn book compiled for the foundlings with specially written hymns for them to sing. And it's shot through with lines basically where the foundlings sing about how grateful they are to be saved in this way by others. From 1763 also, we see something that Thomas Coram, had he been alive by then, would have been really dead against. From 1763, mothers write petitions to explain their distress, their destitution, and their need for assistance. They have to make a case for the child to be taken in. And it is really, really tragic to read these awful, awful pleas. And sometimes they're accepted, sometimes they're rejected. Throughout the 19th century, children continued to pay the price for being poor and for having no parents. New rules for admission are brought into the Foundling Hospital in 1800. And this is a list of the questions that mothers have to answer when they apply to have their child taken in. It's fairly detailed, and then it's also followed up by the Foundling Hospital secretary to make sure they're telling the truth. It happens, it helps enormously if you have someone who's a respectable person in the ideas of the time to support your case. This is one of the gentlemen who will research the petitions and applications of mothers in those early part, those early years in the 1800s, John Brownlow. And again, it's really telling about the stigma that is attached to being in the care system at this time, that he is actually brought up in the Foundling Hospital. He arrives as a baby in 1800, and he is the only person ever to become secretary to the governors from the Foundling Hospital population. It is also telling that when he dies, his widow writes to the governors about this memorial. You can see, on the right here. And in the memorial tablet, she, discussing the wording of it, she says, "I think it unnecessary to tell my grandchildren that their dear and honoured grandfather was brought up at the Foundling Hospital. Would it not answer better to say that he served the hospital of governors faithfully over 50 years?" So that he wants, that she wants no mention of his original life there as a child. And in fact, John Brownlow himself, even though he writes quite humanely in an informed way about being in the care system at that time, he tends to see himself as an exception in terms of his achievements as a foundling rather than being typical of them. The workhouse, for that matter, at this time, which is the alternative to the Foundling Hospital, is even more about stigma. It is expressly, from 1834 onwards, about saying, making it horrible to be a deterrent to the poor so that they don't want to go there. A key element in the legislation makes that explicit. It's also interesting, in the 1800s, Charles Dickens' book Oliver Twist includes the character Noel Claypole, who as an insult calls Oliver workhouse when he's talking to him. So fast forward quickly, things stayed basically the same for a long time. And in 1926, the Foundling Hospital's residential children's home, if you like, and school moved to Berkhamsted. And this is its rather glorious incarnation today as a normal secondary school called Ashlands. Whoops, excuse me, sorry. Just get back to where I was. I'm just trying to get back to my screen, David. If you could try and put that back on. I hope you can hear me. I'm not sure if I can still see, I can see this, but anyway, I'll crack on. Okay. I'm guessing I can't share my screen. I'll crash on anyway. So Ashlings is there as a school for now it's the Thomas Coram Foundation School, Thomas Coram School for much of the 20th century. In the 1940s, at the end of the Second World War, the Curtis Report comes out. And for that, that again is an absolutely crucial stage in our story. The Curtis Report looks at the experiences of children in care and essentially says children in the care system should be treated just the same as other children, which sounds pretty obvious to us today, perhaps, but essentially it's a landmark. So now it's not about having them in separate schools. It's not about having to wear separate uniforms. It's about going to normal schools. It's about living in families. It's about wearing your own clothes, because even in the 1940s, the children still wear uniforms. And I suppose in the end, it sounds like where we should be today, where we expect to be today. But I think in terms of the final slide, which I actually can't get to show you, but my final slide for this really is to look, there we go, thank you. In 1966, interesting to look at this film, Kathy Come Home, Ken Loach's extraordinary film, Play for Today, on BBC, watched by 12 million people at the time. It tells the story of Kathy and Reg, who get married and looks all set for a lovely life together. Reg loses his job, they lose their home, and it's essentially how they go through the care system. And for all the ideas of improvements and developments over the centuries, the stigma really comes across. The way that she is spoken to, the way the children are spoken about, the way that not just the professionals, but society in general treats them and regards them. I hope things have changed now, but I think we're going to have a look and discuss whether that is actually the case. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carol. So we have there a journey over more than 200 years that shows the enduring stigma from the origins of the Foundling Hospital through to the transfer of the school in the 1950s. And now to start to look towards the present and the future, it's my pleasure to invite Robin Hughes, who has been participating in the Voices Through Time programme and our campaign, to read her poem. Thank you, Robin.
Hello, thank you. No longer a name, but a number. Everyone is loved, but not everyone has foundations to grow. Everyone has a name, but some have forgotten. Everyone has roots, but not everyone's roots make them strong and feel safe. I no longer have a name, I have a number. No, I no longer have a number, I have a name. This name is mine. I will wear it with pride. I will shout it from the rooftops for everyone to hear. One day, everyone will know my name, the things I have done. One chapter of my life is finished, on to the next. My story is ever-changing, but I know one thing. I am no longer a number, I am somebody. My scars won't hurt me. This is who I am. Everyone is loved. I have roots to grow. Everyone has a name. This is mine. My roots will keep me strong and safe. My positivity will keep me strong. I am the light in the darkness. I can't change the past, but I can change the future.
Thank you very much, Robin, with such poignant words to bridge from the past to the period of time of some of our lifetimes. And to introduce this journey is Brigid Robinson, who is the Managing Director of Coram Voice, established 40 years ago as the groundbreaking centre to ensure that the voice of the child is heard in decisions that matter. Brigid.
Good evening, everyone, and I'm really pleased to be here with you tonight. Following on from Carol Harris earlier, I'm going to explore the attitudes to children in care in more recent times and how care experienced young people are taking control of their own narrative. So when you're stigmatized, people make negative assumptions about you based on specific characteristics, e.g. how you look or the group that you belong to. Goffman in 1963 defined stigma as being an attribute that is deeply discrediting. From Elizabethan times until today, there's been a close relationship between entry into care, whether it's the workhouse or care of the state, and poverty. Whilst the link between poverty and coming into care isn't deterministic, it doesn't mean you're poor, therefore you come into care. In 1917, a large-scale study found that children in the UK's poorest communities were over 10 times more likely to enter the care system than those from the wealthiest areas. This relationship between family poverty and going into care, as Carol was talked about, was highlighted in the media in the 1966 groundbreaking film by Ken Loach, Kathy Come Home, where Kathy's children are forcibly removed from her and taken into care. It is conceivable to argue that the relationship between the two, being poor and going into care, whether rightly or wrongly, is ingrained in societal thinking. The response to poverty in England shifts over time. However, underpinning it is the view that people should not be dependent on the state and the idea that being poor is bad and is the fault of the individual. When children come into the care system, the state, however, takes on the role of parent. And this parent, unlike other parents, echoes the views of state dependency. Therefore, whilst the care system was established to protect children, it was not focused on redressing the deficit caused by disadvantage prior to coming into care, and importantly, did not appear to support children as they moved into adult life. The concept of leaving care for children isn't even mentioned in the 1969 Children and Young People's Act. Care orders merely ended for young people, or they could choose to leave at 16 if they wanted to, with the idea being that young people then, as adults, were out on their own and, unlike their peers, without family support or anywhere to go back to. I recall, as a young care leaver at the end of the 1980s, applying to university and having to describe myself as a technical orphan on my grant application, as for the purposes of applying to university, I was defined as having no family. Even as our understanding of the support young people need to move to adulthood has improved, we still have a compressed and accelerated movement to adulthood for care leavers and the idea that this is okay. In 1989, the Children Act, for the first time, mentioned children leaving care, and it made provision for local authorities to advise, assist and befriend children or young people up until the age of 21. And this minimal support remained in place until this century, when at the same time, the average age for leaving home was about 28 years old. In fact, it wasn't until 2000 with the Children Leaving Care Act that support to care leavers was formalised, until first 21 and then later to 25. This support, however, didn't mean that young people could stay with their carers, but they could be supported whether they lived independently or in semi-independent accommodation. It wasn't until staying put in 2014 that young people had the ability to stay in foster care once they were over 18, and the majority of them still don't, and still don't have the opportunity to do that. Alongside this expectation that young people should be self-sufficient at a much younger age, we also see the construction of the care system as kind of joining together children in need of protection with children deemed to be in need of control. In the 1969 Children and Young People's Acts, it lists the reasons why children would be taken into care. And they are, I'm not going to go through them all, but they are protection from harm, for example, and then also being beyond the control of a parent or guardian, or truanting from school. Given this, it is no surprise that children's homes were viewed as being filled with troubled teenagers, or as you may have heard, naughty boys. We see this also play out in the media with the most famous child in care, Tracy Beaker. And whilst the show brought children in care into the public's living rooms, its depiction of the children's home as a dumping ground filled with naughty children did nothing to counter negative images. That children in care rarely live with their families also positions them as being different, as it strays from what people consider to be everyone's reality, that children are brought up in families regardless of the different type of family construction. We'll all be familiar with primary schools asking children to draw families' trees and children's books and adverts showing pictures of families caring for children. For children in and leaving care, navigating this space can be difficult, as whilst the majority live in foster care, for many this may not be a permanent home and many already have a family. This makes a simple question of how is your family very difficult. For example, as a young adult who'd been in care, I had a mum and two foster families to whom I was very close. So to answer the question, who did I refer to and what difficult questions could it raise? Over the last 40 years, however, care experienced children and young people have been leading the discourse to increasingly highlight practices that are stigmatising and to help professionals understand what it's like to be in care and how the care system could be improved. In 1979, an organisation called NAPIC was set up by Care Experience Young People. And between then and 1994, they campaigned and began to influence the care system with a growing voice of young people. They campaigned against practices that they considered were stigmatising, such as the use at the time of the clothing order book, with their Ban the Book campaign. And the clothing order book was, the campaign was to stop children in care only being able to buy clothes from the limited number of shops that would accept a council order book rather than cash. And also something that immediately identified them as not living with their families. Importantly, NAPIC contributed to major changes introduced by the Children Act, and the Children Act was groundbreaking for the rights of children in care. Not only, as I mentioned earlier, did it reference leaving care, but for the first time it recognised that children in care had the right to have their wishes and feelings taken into account and their right to have a say in the decisions that affected their lives. They also, on top of that, they gave the right to make a complaint if they weren't happy with decisions, and importantly, the right to have their racial origin, culture and language taken into account. At the same time as this, the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, which was ratified in 1991, gave children rights in their own right, rather than in relation to adults. And importantly, much the same as the Children Act, gave them the right to be involved and participate in decisions about them. Since NAPIC, children in care and care leavers have increasingly led the discourse, either through national organisations like a National Voice, local children in care councils, charities, and also through the power of working together and using social media. The voice of young people has highlighted practices that are stigmatising to children, just as NAPIC did. And one of these included the campaign to end bin bags, which was the practice where when children, young people were being moved from placement to placement, they often didn't have suitcases. So their clothing and belongings were put in bin bags, and those bin bags were used to move them. As one young person said at the time, "Bin bags are for carrying rubbish. What does that say about me?" We know that children in care and care leavers still report experiencing stigma today, despite changes over the years, and they worry about being labelled or judged if their care background is known. In 2020, a Coram Voice report looked at challenging stigma in the care system. And from that, they found that 12% of young people aged 11 to 18 felt that adults did things which made them feel embarrassed about being in care. Whilst in many ways, this is a really positive finding, as 88% didn't feel embarrassed, the survey highlighted many important issues that are true for a lot of care experienced children and young people. For example, that the care system uses stigmatising jargon in reports and professionals when they talk to or about young people, such as placement or contact, and how this can contribute to children's sense of feeling different. For example, I remember a few years ago being in a meeting with a young person who was in care, and professionals were referring to LAC, looked after children, to which he responded, "I'm not a LAC, I'm a teenager." Young people described also not feeling that they were getting to own their own personal story. Rather, they talk about how personal details are shared in front of them without their consent. And one young person in the report talked about when we're out and about and they start talking to random strangers and tell them I'm in care. "I don't want random people to know my personal info. It should be me saying it, not them." Overall, what children in care and care leavers in the report talked about was that they didn't want to be treated differently from their peers, singled out, or their care status highlighted. They wanted their successes to be celebrated. In March 2021, Coram commissioned a YouGov survey to carry out an online poll of 2,092 UK adults on their views of children in and leaving care. The findings from this are going to be released for Care History Month at the beginning of April, and Care History Month covers the whole of April. However, I wanted to give you a sneak preview of one area. The first question we asked people was, what first comes to mind when you think about the term children in care? Are you able to? Thank you, David. 69% of people responded, and the results of their first answer are shown here on the slide. what you will see from the words there is that although the answers do not highlight a view of children and young people as troublemakers, what is stark is that there's very little that's positive in the responses either. There is no mention of achievement, successes, resilience, or aspiration. And it is this image of care experienced children that children and young people have started to counterbalance the discourse on, and often supported by professionals, highlighting their strengths, abilities, and positioning themselves as individuals that are more than their care experience. If we could show the second slide. Thank you. As this slide from children who were from Dudley shows, in contrast, how children would define themselves, and it's interesting to contrast, they're asking different questions, but it's interesting to contrast the words on the two slides. So I'll leave you for a second to have a look at those. The voices of care experienced children highlighting their reality are a powerful force for change. And it is the positioning of care experienced children and young people as constructing their own discourse that the Voices Through Time programme that we've been talking about today seeks to champion. We have a campaign called hashtag Real Stories of Care and the reclaiming by young people of their history and how they choose to be defined. You will have seen this through the showcase of the powerful work both earlier and later on in this presentation by care experienced young people that we are working with. Many local authorities have also taken on board changing the narrative for care experienced children and young people, with one local authority developing a project called Project Positive to raise the aspirations of children in care and reduce the stigma associated with care leavers applying for jobs. The idea of the campaign came from a care leaver who was frustrated by the negative stereotype that she felt followed her around. The campaign highlighted the reasons for employing care leavers and additional skills that they might have gained from their personal experience, such as being able to voice their concerns and opinions in meetings with professionals or solving problems independently. I'll leave you with a thought. To imagine a world that, rather than feeling sorry for or judging children in care and care experienced young people feeling embarrassed, that they could feel proud of their care experience, was celebrated for it, and the care system was viewed as something positive. I now have the pleasure to introduce Mariam, who's going to read a poem for us. I'll pass you over to Mariam. Thank you.
Hi, guys. My name is Mariam Najari. I am ambassador for Coram, and I'm also part of the Young People's Panel in my council, helping children's services change and review pathway plans and so on. So I wrote a poem about my life and how I felt in care. To you, I am the same on the outside, whilst on the contrary, we are nothing alike. Basic, easy functions, yet cannot function in real life. Every day I sit and watch the world go by, slowly wishing someone would just say hi. Fighting for basic necessities alone, whilst others have their parents fighting for them. The lonely young soul in the world with no guidance or love from their parents. No life skills taught or hobbies found. No one cares, so I don't make a sound. Stripped of my innocence, made to feel different, silenced when outspoken, yet failed by the system. Seen as nothing but a statistic, but no more will I be a number. I just want to be loved. I just want a mother or father. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mariam. And also thank you so much to Brigid for that review of our contemporary lived experience of the stigma of care. And now we're going to open up to questions, and you have a Q&A function available to you, which I hope you will start to populate with questions that you would like to put to the panel of young people, and Brigid and Carol as social historian and, as you can see, distinguished leader of Coram Voice. And we're joined also by young people you've heard from, and also from Aaron, whose work we're going to see later. So I'm really interested to get your questions. And as you know, on these webinar formats, it is quite complicated and difficult to see who people are. So please do use the Q&A function to ask questions. And I believe, David, that we have a question from, we may have a question coming to us from Jenny Coles, who's joined us. But I'm going to actually ask Aaron, who very kindly has volunteered to get the questions started, and to ask his fellow panelists a question to get the discussion going. Aaron.
What would you do to instigate change in regards to stigma of care experienced young people and care leavers?
This is the $64,000 question, and Aaron, thank you for it, because I also think something very important about that is you said, what would you do? So I think the implication being that all of us have a collective responsibility and can do things ourselves, as well as suggesting what others might do. So who would like to answer that question first, or have a go with that question? Robin, do you feel you'd like to offer a thought on what you could do?
If you can repeat the question, then maybe.
Yeah. I think, you know, Robin, I think you guys are actually doing it, which is to draw attention to the diverse talents and resilience of young people who are care experienced. Brigid, can I come to you to ask you what you feel we can all do?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's some really interesting learning that we already have from things that young people have said. So as I talked a bit about in my presentation, being mindful of the language we use. So, you know, not talking about contact, talking about seeing your family, not calling young people lack, calling them young people. So some very, some kind of very, very straightforward things. And I think also, you know, one of the things for me is about the, and young people have spoken about this, the importance to see young people in care as individuals, and to kind of celebrate their individual strengths rather than being part of a system. You know, many local authorities, there's many practitioners who do that really well, and there's kind of good initiatives to do that. But I think kind of more globally, you know, as you were saying before, I think to create a different perception of young people, I think one of the really powerful things is young people themselves taking that discourse and challenging the kind of the view of children in care as, you know, the stigmatizing issues around being a child in care, and actually putting across themselves how they'd like to be described, their talents, their aspirations and their abilities, and taking the opportunity to celebrate that.
Thank you, Brigid. And we've got a very interesting question here from Chloe, who is in the Q&A, who's saying she thinks it's so sad that she's only just learned about NAPIC in the last month. And what can we do to spread the word about our history as brilliant activists and policymakers? Now, I'll ask Carol to look through history a bit longer, but Brigid, you were drawing attention to NAPIC and its importance. So what do you think we could do to celebrate that history of activism?
Is that to me or to Carol?
That's to you, and then we're going to turn to Carol to point up a history.
I mean, I think it's a really good question, and a really good point. I suppose what I was just wondering is, we have Care History Month coming up for the first time in April, and this is the, you know, and it's the first Care History Month that has ever happened. So this is the opportunity to celebrate that. And perhaps that's what we should be doing in terms of highlighting NAPIC and, you know, and the power of young people in making change and campaigning.
Yes, And Carol, I think you have a name from the past, Florence Davenport Hill, yes. Who is one that none of us have probably heard about. Yeah. And Mariam, I'll come to you in a moment. You've got your hand, but Carol, yes?
Yeah, just a few quick points briefly. Yes, Florence Davenport Hill. I mean, it's both encouraging and depressing that in 1868, she wrote a book that really just said, look, you know, we should put children in the care system in the context of other children's lives, you know, family life and what's important to them. It's not about stigmatizing them and putting them in a separate category. And it's depressing in terms of we're still having that conversation. But yeah, she was really important in changing the mindset at the time. I think a couple of other things quickly to say. One of the things I think is really important in terms of how we get change is challenge all the time. I mean, we've seen in our lifetimes different attitudes towards, you know, we challenge sexism at work, we challenge racism, we challenge all sorts of things that used to be part of mainstream conversation in ways that left a lot of us feeling uncomfortable, and that the attitudes have changed in terms of what's acceptable and it's not. And actually, I can see someone's also made this same point on the chat as well, that you know, we should be thinking about that in terms of care and care experience. The other thing I think in terms of specifics is that it's interesting, Ken Loach, who made Kathy Come Home, which I think should be shown, frankly, because it's such a devastating film to watch even now. It should be shown again. But he said if he made an updated version, he could well see having exactly that kind of context today, where the stigma and the way that decisions are made about but not with people in the system. And we could do that certainly when we talk about the experiences as we have tonight of being a child in the care system. There are so many things that we see as just totally outrageous. Would we like to be treated like that if we were young people in the care system today? Absolutely not.
Mariam, I think you wanted to come in on this point.
I just thought that another way we could tell the history is all these like packs you get when you first go into care, why does none of that actually state the history? Because I didn't know any of this until now.
It's not that. I think that's a really good, sorry if I may, that's a really good point, because actually, and this is the really shocking thing that inevitably from the historian's point of view I have, that so much of this stuff comes up, not across 100 years, but across 200 years, across decades. It's time and time again. These same issues.
So I'm going to make a pledge to you, Mariam, as chief executive of the oldest children's charity. We will do just that.
Really?
Amazing. Let's do it together through our Voices Through Time programme, and let's make sure that the positive aspects of care, the resilience of the children and young people, is shown in the context of that history. So thank you for that suggestion. Let's do it. And I wanted to bring in Georgia, who's a solicitor, who asks perhaps a different vantage point here in her question, which is, what do young people feel could be better managed through their experience of care proceedings? Now, that is such an important aspect of this journey. Now, do any of you feel that you have a view on how that could be improved? If you don't, that's fine. Oh, Mariam is in again. She's quick off the mark. Mariam, go for it.
I have a lot to say. So I think, first of all, we should start with communication, because things take, for example, you get told this might take 2 weeks to sort. You wait 2 weeks and you hear nothing. You have to then chase them up, or that was my case, and you find out actually it's going to be 6 weeks now, but no one updated you. So number one, you're left to feel, am I not good enough to be updated with information? Number two, like, it's your life, so why aren't they telling you and updating you with how long stuff is going to take? And yeah, I think with basic communication and just letting people know, people would get on a lot better, like children and staff together.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Aaron wanted to answer as well.
Yeah, I think Miriam already kind of said, but the relationship between the young people and basically the first line of defence, the social workers, the support workers, key workers, when you put a certain element of a system into it, it kind of removes the heart and the soul of these are people at the end of the day. These are young, vulnerable people that need support. And so I think that is definitely what needs to improve.
Thank you. I think Matthew Campbell-Hill might sympathise with that, because in his question, he's saying to a person who's not been in care but works alongside it, it seems the whole journey is one without an anchor, and that constantly being aware of a lack of control to change that for yourself, which if things are constantly changing, as Mariam says, and there's no communication about those changes, makes it even more like being a ship without an anchor. So thank you for that comment from Matthew. And there's a question here from Claire Thomas, and I'm sure you've all got much to say, guys, on this subject, which is it's about the school, the relationship to school. So the first of all, the journey of enabling young people in the care system not to be in an institutional school, as the Foundling Hospital was, but in mainstream school. But do schools do this well now? Are schools trauma-informed and care-experienced aware? How could that be better? What's been your experience? What would you change? Any responses there? Mariam's got her finger on that buzzer again. Mariam, what would you change?
So I think when I was in care personally, I don't think it was that great. I have seen the changes myself in my town. Don't really know about other cities, but when I initially went into care, I was taken out of school until all court orders and stuff was made. And at the beginning, I actually really enjoyed school. So I was like, but I want to go. They told me that I had to be out. They had to let everyone know before I went back in, which then I thought, oh, right. So now everyone's going to know. And then I noticed that not only weren't they trained in confidentiality, but some teachers who didn't like me and thought I was a tearaway kid used that against me and would say, oh, it's because you're a kid from care. But he would say it out loud in a classroom. And I just thought, well, if you think I'm that kid, I'll show you that I'm that kid. And then that's where it all goes downhill.
Yes. So responding to the expectation.
Yeah.
And create a negative cycle. Robin wanted to come in, and then we'll come to Aaron.
When I was at school, me and my sisters were all like in the same place, and we all went to the same school. I really liked school to begin with, and then we came into care, and I did not like school anymore. The second primary school I went to, I was made to kind of feel like an outsider. Like I had no friends there at all, like from the teacher and everything. And the day we came into care, I remember us going into the school office. We had our social workers there. We were all there and everything. And I remember rightly, we literally just left from school there and then didn't even go and get any of our stuff. But my older sister, she's worked in primary schools before, not primary schools, secondary schools, with care experienced people. And she's worked with them and gone to their meetings. And they felt really negatively about school. But as she's been a care experienced person working with them, she's made them feel like quite positive about them being in care. And there are positives to this as well.
Mm. Yes, thank you. And just one thing to point out to the audience, that young people have worked with Coram Life Education to create some toolkits for primary schools to try and avoid this constant repetition of family trees. And so on, which comes round time and time again, but also to help teachers to address the national curriculum requirements, but be much more sensitive to the kinds of issues that it might raise. Aaron, did you want to come in?
When I went into care, was at the same time I was transitioning from high school to sixth form, and I can remember that it wasn't too different from before and after, because I had one teacher that was actually just really supportive. And like, there was a lot of stuff that was changing, like, because I'd gone from living with my family to living to a hostel. I didn't have any support washing my clothes, so I was coming in smelling. Sometimes I didn't have a uniform, and it was like they would let me use some of the school's facilities and stuff whenever I needed to just have a chat and just breathe. Like, I had a lot of support. So I think it really is definitely about how you approach it, especially in school when you're there every single day. It's nice to have someone to anchor you.
Mm. Well, thank you, Aaron. And one of the other small things that we've done is to produce a children's book called Captain Coram, Champion for Children. And we were able to send that to every primary school in the country so that all children should be able to see this story and that perhaps a small gesture. There is a question here which I think is really interested, which is about the role of the media in this. And Carol and Brigid have both shown in the story the importance of novels from Tom Jones and Oliver Twist and Tracy Beaker and how important that is. But what's the responsibility and the role of the media in trying to tackle this? And Miriam's there again. She's come forward. Go on, Miriam, go for it.
So I used to find that the media and, well, yeah, from the people writing online or in papers, they view people in care very negatively. And obviously a lot of people form their opinions on what they read. So I took it upon myself personally to volunteer and message Hereford Times in my council. And I now am a journalist for them, and I write my own articles, and I am writing on behalf of all children in care and trying to just change the stigma and how people speak about us. And hopefully if they see a child from care that's gotten this far and now is writing articles for a newspaper like People, then hopefully I can show people that no matter what people say about you and put about you in the media, that you can do as well as any other person. So yeah, I think we ourselves need to get ourselves in the media section and change everything.
That's so inspiring, Miriam, and that's just brilliant. I'm so proud that you're doing that. And I do think that this world that you live in, which has a social media access, you know, there is a democratization of media there. And that's one of the things we can do, is actually just get out there and convey the positive images. That's the hashtag Real Lives of Care. You know, each person is an individual and each has a voice. And fortunately, access to media is perhaps a lot easier than it used to be. Except that, as Brigid said, Kathy Come Home was watched by 12 million people simultaneously. So of course, with the expanse of media that we have now, it can be perhaps, you don't perhaps get the same kind of presence. But I also wondered also about conveying the collective view of young people in care, Brigid. I thought you might say something a little bit around the findings from Bright Spots around the experiences of younger children also and their voice being heard.
Yeah, so I think, so the Bright Spots work is basically, it's based on what children and young people think about their own care experience journey and their own well-being. So it's based on the set of questions that were developed with children and young people from the ages of 4 until 25. So it's split into different age groups, and actually and it's great that it actually manages to get the views from younger children, because it's really difficult sometimes to hear from younger children what they think about in care. And actually for the younger group of children, the under 11s, most of them, I think it was about 86%, feel that kind of being in care is a positive. They felt it was a positive experience for them. And they talk about kind of having trusted relationships and feeling supported. Children do also talk about kind of stigma and about things that schools can do, wanting to have pets, sometimes not able to have pets. There's not much in there about a kind of a collective voice of children, but actually what it does do, coming together. But what it does do, the Bright Spots work, is we now have undertaken the Bright Spot surveys over the last few years with, I think it's up to about 15,000 children and young people who are in and leaving care, which makes it the largest kind of database of care experience, young people's views in the country. And it's a really valuable insight in terms of for young people, how they experience the care system and actually what's important for them, kind of based on what they feel.
Thank you, Brigid. And I mean, what those surveys do show is that there's quite a difference depending on the stability or otherwise of the time in care, and that for young people leaving care, there is a particular feeling of being without that anchor, potentially.
Yeah.
It was interesting to me that 2014 was a staying put piece of legislation, and I commend everybody in the sector for the fight to get staying put. But of course, Thomas Coram created an organisation that hardwired support for those young people, and they were 21.
Can I also say something that I think really
yes.
not to miss, that I think is important for us. This is, I've been really kind of 100 years and we're still going over the same issues. One of the things that really is massive, I think, is the fact that it is really recent to actually ask children in the care system anything about what you think, what you want, and that kind of idea, as obviously from your experiences you're talking about. And that has to be really transforming, because it really does bring home a different perspective that actually is much more about the quality and the subjectivity as well of, you know, it's not a one size fits all, it's not a load of acronyms, it's actually about people and individuals actually leading those conversations. So I think that's a really important sort of change and shift. And I also say, I think it will be messy. I think it is messy. People don't like the challenge sometimes. And I think we can all see that happening in terms of discussing things that have been done this way for a long time. It's not just Thomas Coram sort of challenging society a few hundred years ago. It's getting change now. It starts to get angry. People start to get upset about it, but it's all good. It's all progress. So yeah, keep on. I think it's great.
But I think the point is really important that, you know, we've all heard a child should be seen and not heard. And that's been true of children generally, and particularly true for children in the care system or dependent upon that system. It's a really relatively recent development that the idea that a child and particularly a young person in care actually has that right to be heard. And so now that, you know, if that right is there, then let's speak loudly. And one of the points that's come across from Matthew again is that, I think it's Matthew, no, sorry, it isn't Matthew, it's Elaine, that in the past, the Foundling Hospital was supported by artists and writers, and we spoke about some of those writers, and does support from the arts help young people? Is that a way of changing the image, changing the record? Aaron, now we know you're great creative. So Aaron, what's your view on that? Aaron, you're on mute.
Well, brilliant. I said, since this is the coming age of technology, it is so easy to pass and share stuff around. And since everyone's flicking through their Instagram and their TikToks and it's 6-second videos, if you could get to someone in those 6 seconds and reinvent their perspective and they share it and they share it, then it is definitely a domino effect. And that's ultimately how you change stigma.
I think that's right. I draw attention also to the very interesting installation by Lem Sisse that many of you will know in our Foundling Museum, which is called Superman is a Foundling, which is just an extraordinary instantaneous shift in perspective, Aaron, of the kind that you talk about, but also the importance of access to the arts for young people themselves, to dance, to sing, to perform, to visit the theatre. And that's something that Shakespeare Schools Foundation, Coram Shakespeare Schools Foundation, tries to promote. So that the expressive voices is also really, really important. So there's a different question here, which is from Rosie, which is on a different point, which is how do you, can you see ways in which all that process that's around young people in care, the meetings, the reports, could they be made less formal or more attuned? What would you recommend to the professionals on the call who care deeply but are in a regulated system with all these sorts of forms and things that they have to fill in? What would your advice to them be?
Pre-fill as much as you can before giving it to us, because sometimes we have to fill out loads of stuff. We get bored, we don't put as much effort into it. If there's meetings, unless we, like, does it, yeah, just basically speak amongst each other. Is it really necessary to have 5 meetings in a month? Like, there's no need.
It's a very good point. Robin, you had a thought there.
Yeah, if there are care experiences, like when we have meetings on that, why don't we co-host the meetings with the person leading it as well? So it's our meetings and we're taking in charge of our future and us, and not letting everybody else decide what's going on, because then we're not involved in it.
Such a great point. And I sit through many meetings where people talk about data sharing. We've got to be able to data share. There's one person who knows all the information.
Yeah, exactly.
And so your point, exactly. I think Brigid wanted to come in on that point.
It was actually a really similar point to you, Robin, about, you know, thinking for professionals, thinking where meetings are held, not doing them in school time, social workers not having children coming out of classes for meetings, holding them at places where children and young people feel comfortable, making sure they know who's going to be coming to the meetings and why they're there. And I think, you know, the point that you're making, Robin, and there are local authorities that do this, where young people run their meetings and they have a say and they set the agenda. And I think actually that's really important.
Thank you. So, well, we're coming towards our close, but we do have a similar question. I, in fact, can't tell the name, but it's about young people helping other young people. Are there any buddy systems so that, you know, as young people set out in care, as well as when they leave care, could there perhaps be better ways in which young people can support each other in those processes? What do you think? Miriam's got a hand up again.
I think, just like being ambassador for this, I think there should be a scheme running alongside people in care for the people who have left care, like myself, like a ambassador scheme thing. So we can, for example, because obviously staff only work Monday to Friday, so on the weekends when stuff go wrong, who can they speak to? They can't speak to other people not in care. I was about to say normal people, but we're normal too. Other people who haven't been in care, because they haven't experienced it and wouldn't know who to turn to or what to do. So therefore, I think there should be a scheme for people like me who's left, to support them with give them my email for the weekends when they need help, so we can signpost them to the right places. And yeah, just support them as well, because it's all good and well being there Monday to Friday when they don't even answer their phones anyway, but the weekend you're by yourself, and if you're a kid, what are you meant to do?
Great. Shall we just do that too? Anyway, I'll leave that with Brigid to answer the question. Robin, and then Aaron.
My sister had an idea. I know I talk a lot about my sister, but she has tried working with the council, my local authority, to make changes for care experience people. And she suggested to have a peer group. Like, so it'd be care experience people, like care leavers or people currently in the process of leaving care, mentor younger care experience people. We like volunteering, but we'd have all the right training for it. We'd be like mini social workers without having all the hard work that you have to go to uni for. We're just people who've gone through the system, can help them on their way, you know, like be a friend for them as well, like knowing that they're not alone.
That's great. Thank you, Robin. Aaron, did you want to comment?
Yeah, I actually have an example of a group just like this. I was in when I was just before I went into care, and also just after it as well. And it was called Boys Group, which was just very inclusive and, well, kind of exclusive. But yeah, they done loads of activities, like they done like a teaching session where they teach how to cook or teach you just general safety and just something educational. And then we do something sports, and then we'd eat dinner together, and it was very inclusive now. But yeah, it was very good for keeping me away from, I was in a hostel and it wasn't the best environment. So it was nice to kind of keep safe in a way.
Okay, thank you. As ever, you all have the answers that we need. And we're going to start to draw to a close, but with just one last question for each of you from Denise, which is, what one word would you use to describe the character or future aspiration for young people in the care system in 2021 on the 280th anniversary of its creation? So I'm going to ask Brigid, then Carol, then Robin, then Miriam, and give Aaron the last word before we go into Aaron's film. So one word, Brigid.
I think that's so hard, but I'm going to go with inspirational.
Okay, and Carol? You're on mute, Carol.
Yeah, I'm going to have to explain it. I'm going to say resourceful, because I think the experience you gain is just, you know, it's almost like, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And you've got tons of that if you've been through the care system.
Thank you. Robin?
I'm going to say achievable, just because everything is achievable.
Right, brilliant. Miriam?
I always have a lot to say, so I can't think of just one word. but I want to say strong and together, because you build up resilience and become strong without even realizing. And although you might feel alone in the system, we're actually all together in this. And yeah, we're all in one sinking boat.
that was quite a few words, but we'll let you off. Aaron, a single word from you.
Included, with the aspiration to ultimately just be seen as a normal person.
So I would like to leave us with the wordle that the panel has just created to describe the character and the aspiration for our young people in care. Inspirational, resourceful, achieving and achievable, strong together, and included. That's what we dedicate ourselves to. You have inspired us tonight, and we are going to close tonight's event with that commitment. You can join in the hashtag Real Stories of Care. You can listen to the podcast that Jules told us about. You can visit corumstory.org.uk. But most of all, you can reflect on Aaron's film. So thank you for joining us. And if we could share Aaron's film after that, good night.
With the world on his shoulders and a limp in his stride, and with all the eyes on him and nowhere to hide, daily battles with demons he endures on inside, monsters not of his making, though in him they reside. Though the world wants to judge him, or better, to guide, when the demons come knocking, who stood by his side? And please, what care did these people ever provide but to trample and tarnish and throttle his pride? So they say it's his fault, and they say that they tried. So they say he's the problem, or at least they implied. It would all have been easy if he just complied. Well, that's easy to say when your life isn't fried. Have you ever tried living whilst wishing you died? No, of course, well, why would you? Your whole life is supplied. His whole life is neglected, infected, untied. He was promised protection, and yet although they lied, he's the one they expected to laugh when he cried. He's the one they rejected whilst they ogled side-eyed. He's the one they excluded, felt trapped but outside. but how different they'd see things if their worlds did collide. If the world was to flip and they felt the landslide. With the world on their shoulders, how far would they stride?
Good night, everybody.
Forget your troubles. Get happy.
I'm here again.
You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah.
So let's sing a song.
Come on, get happy.
Of cheer again.
Get happy ready days for the judgment day. The sun is shining. Come on, get happy.
Shout it now.
The Lord is waiting to take
who
your
can
hand.
Doubt it now.
Shout hallelujah.
So let's tell the world.
And just get happy
about it now.
We're
happy
going
days
to the promised
land. Here again.
We're heading across the river. Soon your cares will all be gone.